Hi guys, thanks for coming and taking the time out to watch my video. I just want to say it might take a minute, so I did get a fresh cup of tea and it's really hot right now. So maybe you want to get one too and just pause this, do that, get a little snack and come back. So now that you're back with your snack and your tea and your inquiring minds, I guess I'll just start by saying that So I've had a crazy health situation, crisis, new lifestyle for the time being going on since, well, maybe the last 2.5 years, but really I would say back in November of 2015, I had like a month of severe sciatic nerve pain that was predominantly my left side going down the back of my leg, you know, into my heel and all that. But then for a while it was both legs, and it was so intense that it was literally like 24/7 around the clock. No matter what I did, it was like having like a thunder electricity storm, like just going nonstop. And it was really, really stressful and hard to handle physically. I don't take narcotic drugs because they make me super sick, and so I didn't really have a lot of relief from it, and it was just really intense. And that happened in November, like right before Thanksgiving, and then on December 7th of that same year, I get a lot of neck tension, and I did a lot of serving, like waitressing and bartending for a long time, and so I like moved bunches of kegs and lifted heavy trays and things like that. And so I've had just a lot of tension and soreness in my neck, and I got headaches and things like that. But I had went to stretch my neck that day, and when I stretched, I felt like, oh, that was not a good idea, that did not feel good. And then within just seconds, I felt like somebody like tased me in the back. I've never been tased, but if I could guess what it would be like, I would think that it was pretty close. And it was so intense, and it was like, I don't know, it was just so shocking, to use like the most obvious word. But within the next few hours, my toes on my right foot started to curl under, and my fingers started to twitch and shake. And I don't know if some of you remember back at the Christmas party, but my hands started shaking, and within 2 weeks it had taken over my whole body, and it looked like I had like an early onset Parkinson's thing. It was, ooh, I'm gonna start to have involuntary movement right now actually, because I'm getting some incredibly sharp nerve pain in my elbow, and that's so it goes. I'm just doing my thing, feeling normal, and then all of a sudden I have some excruciating pain experience that dysregulates my nervous system, or continues to keep it dysregulated. But anyways, I don't even remember, something about the nerve pain, okay, shaking fingers, okay, yeah. So it kind of took over my whole body, and I was really, really overwhelmed with the inability to control my body, really. And it took doctors and emergency rooms and naturopathic medicine and sedatives from the pharmaceutical companies. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be like that. I didn't mean that. I didn't mean that. From the pharmacy. God gives us all sorts of things, and we need anesthetic when we go to get surgery or our teeth worked on, and people have to live with narcotic drugs because they are in so much pain they couldn't otherwise. And I totally don't judge, and I support it, and if I could take some of those things I would, but my system is so sensitive that so many medications just are not worth it for me. So I digress, but I'm really trying to be careful with my words and not to offend or hurt people, because it's not my intention. So that was in December, and it kind of took all over, and using homeopathic medicine and stuff from the emergency room, doctors and stuff, we were able to kind of get my movements under control somewhat. But it was like 4 months where I couldn't drive. I was just a mess. It was a total disruption of life. It was crazy town. Thank you to all of you that prayed for me and supported me and helped me out during those times, because it was legit. It was legit. But anyways, so that all led me to go into the whole neurological doctor realm and wound up going to a neurologist who let us know right away that this was not anything that had a natural organic disease process or degenerative quality, like MS or Parkinson's or anything like that, or lupus. I don't know what if they did check me for Lyme's disease. I think that was also done. So a lot of things that would give off those initial things were kind of set aside, but they really didn't think that there was any connection with my neck. And that was really hard for me to swallow because, no pun intended, but I legit had stretched my neck and then had this problem and it just didn't go away. And there's so much to be said, and maybe this is where I would interject to say the diagnosis that they had gave me was what's called FMD, which is called a functional movement disorder. And so, and also more broadly, FND, which is a functional neurological disorder. And I'm going to take a second to pull up, if I can figure out how to use the laptop, iPad, whatever it is, it's Madeline's. Okay, so I'm pulling up the website and I will link it down below in the description box, but it's for a website all about functional neurological disorder. So again, like I said, what I've been diagnosed with is not something that is degenerating. My brain in itself is fine, but where the problem lies is in that signaling. So let me just read to you exactly what a functional neurological disorder is. So functional neurological disorder is due to a problem with the functioning of the nervous system in a structurally normal brain. So functional symptoms, so like my severe nerve pain or my IBS, my fibromyalgia type symptoms or sensitivities, the muscle spasms and facial dystonias and involuntary movements, none of it comes from there's something damaged. It's more that connectivity. So it's not derived from structural issues, but through the brain's inability to send and receive signals correctly. As a result of this, physical and psychological risk factors can be involved. So for instance, some people can get this when they're 2 years old and it's so sad and they're having seizures, but they're non-epileptic, and people have been in car accidents or had really traumatic, dangerous situations that have happened that have converted into physical symptoms. Like you can think PTSD would fit into this category and things like that, or like I said, irritable bowel syndrome, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome. All these things fit under the umbrella of functional symptoms that they haven't been able to pinpoint in like the actual origin. So it's idiopathic in nature. Some people have a really hard time with that because some doctors, like historically, looked at this as a completely just a psychological issue that could always be linked to trauma of some sort. And yes, I did have a really traumatic past and youth. And then as a side story, that's the side story. The main story is that I've had traumatic health crises, like emergency rooms and ambulances and surgeries and all kinds of things over the years that have just been a super stressful trauma to my system. So could it be that those, I guess I look at it as the pain that I've had unchecked and kind of unmanaged for so long because it's been so nebulous to all these doctors over the years. Finally, it was like my system was like, we're done here. We can't do this anymore. It's too much. And my body's system of controlling all the things that are controlled by your nervous system, which is like everything. It's on the fritz, I guess. So anyways, this term, you know, I told you, functional neurological disorder, it's used to describe all these different symptoms. The thing is that now they're really revamping how they look at it, trying to get more funding because it is considered a rare disease. But then they also say that 1/3 of neurological patients that go into the neurology clinics are for functional symptoms. So, besides, they're like, the reason that people go if you have functional symptoms that they can't find the origin, is like one third out of the patients that go into a neurological clinic. So that's pretty amazing to me. But it's really poorly understood because sometimes people don't have something crazy in their past that they could say, oh, this happened. Or for me, I feel like I had this crazy, overwhelming physical month and a half, and it was too much. But I don't really know, and it doesn't really matter because it is what it is. And now I feel like the reason that it sticks around is because I'm still having such severe chronic pain issues that trigger the movements. Or, well, that's really what keeps it around. But then there's other things, like I'll start to stutter, or if I see randomly a flash of lightning, or the toaster popped the other day and I almost jumped through the ceiling. It's really bizarre, but I'll have like a few, 2, 3, 4 months where things are really weird and difficult and overwhelming. And then I'll have 2, 3 months where it's just pain. And that's like, I don't even care. That's fine. It's easier than having all these bizarre things. So the symptoms, the most common misconception is that FND patients are in control of some or all of their symptoms. Some people think, oh, it's in your head. You know, if it's not physical, if it doesn't have a physical origin, then it's in your head, you're making it up. And, or they say you should go see a neurological psychologist, and people think, whoa, wait a minute, what are you trying to say here? What are you trying to say? So a common misconception is that they're consciously, you know, making this up. But the patient does not consciously, I'm quoting this now, produce functional symptoms. Functional neurological disorder symptoms are often described as appearing suddenly and progressing rapidly, which is what happened to me. Symptoms typically wax and wane, yes, including complete remission and sudden reoccurrences. It's common for other illnesses or physical injury to trigger functional symptoms. Oh, see? For patients to develop functional overlay with concurrent illnesses, which I tend to have as well. And then also the co-occurrence of functional symptoms should not impede care or treatment for the other underlying symptoms, disease courses. I don't know what it's trying to say. Illnesses. So, yeah. And that's really overwhelming because it's like you have to go see, if you have a bunch of stomach issues, you need to go see a gastroenterologist. If you have pain, you need to go to see a pain management doctor or a rheumatologist if they deal with people like us that don't fit into their box very well. And then there's doctors that you go to that are like, yeah, it's functional. Take some psych drugs and hope you figure it out and hope you get better and hopefully it's sooner than later. And bye. And if you ask, I had a couple doctors where I asked for a referral and they're like, this isn't referable. And it's like, okay, my insurance company doesn't need a referral, so I'll just do it myself. Thank you. So, or I'll find other doctors that are supportive, which I have, that can get me referrals that I need. So again, I digress. Symptoms. I kind of told you I have it so good, you guys, compared to some of my new brothers and sisters in the FND community who have they black out, they have seizures, they vomit and defecate on themselves, and they have blindness and severe pain and all kinds of things. And like I have nerve pain and sensory symptoms that set it off, you know. It's just incredible. People can't get in hot water because the heat will set off their triggers, or they can't eat chocolate or caffeine, or it's so complex. So again, they can't really say what causes it. There's, I think for me, it's a cocktail of different things that, and also I'm genetically mutated according to my DNA on some of the parts that deal with the function of some of these things. And so what can you really do? So it's not terribly understood, and some doctors know about it and some doctors are completely oblivious. And I think that's why you can go so many years. I feel like the 13 years of hardship that I've had with severe suffering has been FND this whole time. Potentially I wax and wane on this. But I feel like it was that the whole time. It just wasn't diagnosed until the symptoms got so severe that I had the movement disorder, and then it was like, oh, now we can tell you what this is. And I'm just literally barely touching the surface of that. Yeah, because I do have four bulging discs in my neck with stenosis on each level, but they say that it's not something that I need surgery for at this point. But that, I get severe spasms in the back of my neck that cause nerve pain and movement in my arms, and also severe pain in my rib cage and in my shoulder blade, behind my shoulder blade, and like headaches and things like that. And it's hard because there's nothing I can do per se about that. Well, that's not true. There's so many things I can do. And that's the beauty of this. I have so much hope because there's so many things that I can do. I, for instance, had a situation just like a week ago, and I was just la 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 doing whatever, and I felt like somebody like stabbed me in the ear with like a burning hot ice pick, which is kind of a contradiction in itself, but we'll go with it. And it was so intense that I dropped to the ground on my knees to my face, and it was like, okay, that was really insane. And I jumped back up and got back up, but it had triggered my movement disorder. And so if I would go and hold still, like the other thing is if I'm doing something and working, it will the focus and the overriding, you know, you're choosing neural pathways to take, like I'm going to do this, so your brain's going to take those neural pathways. But if I don't do that, and I just kind of relax my and let go of the tension, which kind of holds the involuntary movement at bay, it will react. So when I had that crazy ear thing, I was like stuttering and shaking, and it was so intense that I was like shaking like this and like making like sounds because it was so strong. It was like I was possessed or something. And it was so set off, like I couldn't do anything without being like so overwhelmed. Like I couldn't go back to doing what I was doing, I thought. So I sat down and tried to just relax, but then my whole arms were like literally flying in the air and my legs just with involuntary like spasticity. And I was like, no, I am not doing this. So I put on headphones and I went to the kitchen and I made dinner. And what was great is that taking that option to go, or that opportunity to go pick another brain pathway and chop, and even though it wasn't easy and I felt like I wanted to be in bed and my family would have made dinner, so don't be like, psh, where were they at? Let me do it, you know? But in a sense, it was really therapeutic for me, because if this is something that they can't say how it comes on exactly or how to stop it, you really have to find tactics to override it. And essentially, with me working and listening to the music and making the food, by the time I was finished with all that and I sat down, it had like dialed back a ton and it was not nearly as intense. And so there's coping mechanisms, there's baths, there's therapy, there's all kinds of stuff. So I'm not going to go on rambling, but again, I got that diagnosis. But then the neck kind of took me on a journey for a while, because my neck issues really trigger my symptoms, and I could literally push on the back of my neck in this one sore spot and trigger off the movements and things. And so it's not that, but I found out with time that it's not that my neck is the origin, but that there's so many things that can trigger that super dysregulated signal sending issues. And so the muscle spasms are real. It's just that somebody's sending or receiving the wrong signal. Either the nerves and the muscles are sending them back, or the brain sending them, vice versa. I don't remember exactly right now how all of it works. But essentially all that is royally off its rocker right now. So, and it's been sticking around. I would say that the last time I was triggered into a new down cycle was like Christmas Day. I caught the flu, and it was like the flu of death. And I'm sure you guys, you know what I'm talking about, right? You got it too. Mm-hmm. And you were sick for like a month and your lungs were burning and they were going to just shrivel up and fall out. I know, I had it. Mm-hmm. But it was like, I wanted to just not be awake for any of it. But that triggered my system to be like from normal with pain to like, oh, okay, maybe I need to secure some rides again, or just roll with the punches, because I just don't know what to expect from day to day. And that's why I can't work a job that I get paid for, because nobody would keep me very long, because I just can't. Anyways, wow. I'm just trying to think, you guys. There's so much going on. So now I'm kind of at the place where I burnt out from doctor's appointments about August of this last year. It was like just too much. I was going to like 2-3 appointments a week, if it would be like trauma therapy, physical therapy, naturopath, neurologist, pain management, you name it, chiropractic, acupuncture. Actually, I don't think I did acupuncture yet for this, which is kind of weird, but the thing is, there's just so many things to do. And then I go through periods where I don't have time to do all that, because I homeschool our daughter, and just taking care of my health from day to day is exhausting. And I could go out for like, if I go to the grocery store, plan a menu, make a list, go to the store, go shopping, come home, put it away, that's it. I'm just completely knackered and done for the rest of the day. And it's just, I put out like 110% of my effort, and I feel like I used to say that I get like 50% productivity. That's what I used to say years ago. But now I feel like I put out like 110% and I get like, I'm hard on myself, but maybe 30-40%, maybe 30% productivity. And that's okay. And I'm learning to be at peace with that, because I know that all things are held in the hand of God, and I believe that He is sovereign and in control over all these things. And I trust Him, and I have a hope for one day for those things to be made new and to cease from striving. And I look forward to that. But for now, we take it a day at a time. We like to laugh and joke about it. Often when I'm in a lot of pain, I sing it out like, ow. And I don't know why, but I guess it's just the way that my body manages it. But it's an ongoing joke here now. Like, we have an operatic ows going around the house. We just have to laugh and make easy of it, because it's literally 24/7 issues. I will go to bed and I can't sleep because there's raindrops dripping so fast from the neighbor's house that I'm thrashing with involuntary movements in my bed, and I have to sleep on the couch or wear earplugs and weird things like that. Or I'm just in too much pain, I can't sleep, and so I stay up praying, or I have to go stalk you people on Facebook, or listen to sermons or rap music or baseball games from 1997 or whatever. But I'll go to bed like that, and then I'll wake up and I'll come out like a zombie gripping my chest, because I've got like a bayonet stabbing through my chest. And so poor Darren, he has to deal with me all the time, but he's an amazing helper and love, and so is Madeline, and I couldn't do this without them and without a lot of you guys. And for those of you that don't know me very well, I look forward to, well, getting to know you, but then also kind of getting to know this new temporary or permanent me. It's not particularly great when it sticks around like it has. If it's something that goes away quickly, they think that that's more how you'd like to see it go, I guess. But that's not so much been the case for me. But I just remind myself that there are people fighting the good fight with this, and they're so much more challenged than I. And so I'm just looking for ways to reach out and to encourage others and to be involved and live my life regardless of what the appearance of the challenge might be for the day, and to know that I have a God that doesn't faint or grow weary, and will see me through it. So this was a long video, and I'm not going to edit it because I don't have the bandwidth for that. So it is what it is. I hope you drank your tea, because I didn't. But I'm going to now, and feel free to leave comments or questions if you want to ask me stuff. I'm totally happy to share. I'm sure there's a lot of things that I left out, but anyways, I hope you give it a thumbs up And you can subscribe and hit the little bell because I do make videos. I did a tutorial for makeup and it was terrible lighting, but I think I did a good job on this one and I figured out some things. So you can tune in for more. It might be cooking, it might be homeschooling, it might be my health is insane, it could be Madeline making art or movie scripts or how to write a book tutorials. I don't know. Subscribe, like, leave a comment. I'm happy to see what happens with all this. This is my first real video, so who knows? Who knows who we might reach, right? You never know who you can influence, you guys. Keep doing good. Keep living the good life with each other, loving one another, whoever you are, whoever's around you, love them. Try to understand them, where they're coming from, and let's just all get along. Mwah! Bye.